are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, welcome to the day before the first exam. I want to go over a little administrivia, as we always do, to remind you of things that are going on that you might not have noticed, since this is there's no physical classroom, since there's a virtual classroom. Also to remind you that if you have questions, you can email askdhtvlive@gmail.com, or you can call the number on the screen, and the message will magically appear on a screen in front of me, so it'll look like I'm looking down, but I'm actually reading the message. So a couple of things I want to point out to you. They're all under content and under announcements. So the first thing I want to point out to you is you have now have a study guide. The study guide is in both PDF and Microsoft Word format. I try to post everything in both formats if I can. The Microsoft Word format is often good if you're going to take notes about the answers to questions on the study guide. The study guide has all the topics that are fair game for the test. In fact, I think I'll open it for you. The study guide starts with when the test is. The test, and we'll talk more about this, I'll send out an announcement, but the test is next Thursday. It will open at 7 a.m. It will close at 11:59. Once you start the test, you have 75 minutes to take the test. Really important, you need to take the exam on a computer and not on a phone or a tablet. Blackboard testing evidently has some problems on a phone or a tablet, and you can get yourself into real trouble if you try taking it that way, because it can quit on you and you have no access sometimes if it quits on you. To access your exam, ignore this right now. We're gonna change this, so this whole thing you can ignore about where to find the test. I will hand out something, make an announcement, send an email about how to find the test. The test is 50 multiple choice items. Your exam will be different from everybody else's. There's 140 total exam questions. And the test, we'll talk more about this on Tuesday at the review session, but the test will include 50 items, 20 thinking questions, and I'll give you some examples, 20 factual questions, 10 questions from the book. You will see that from each lecture I've put exactly what issues I think are important or are possible for the test. I will go through lecture by lecture and give you the high points. I go through the book and tell you exactly what things are possible from chapters 1, 4, 9, and 10. And then magically there are sample questions from an earlier midterm. This is actually from last semester's midterm. I just pilfered questions, and we will go over the answers to these questions on Tuesday. I will not go through these issues from the lectures and the book one at a time. If you want to ask me, I will be here live at 10:30 next Tuesday. I will go over the test in detail and what to expect. I will go through the answers to the 15 questions. If along the way you want to ask me a question, you can email it or call it in with the numbers that are on the syllabus or on the screen when they put them on the screen. And if, for example, you want to know what are the role of cues in communication, all you have to do is write in and say, I have a question from lecture 4 on communication, part B. Can you go over that? I'll be glad to go over it, but I will not start with lecture 1 and go over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, A, B, C, D, etc. I won't do that. I encourage you to come here and ask electronically and get that information. So also under content, under reaction paper assignments, I have posted reaction paper 2. This is really important. It is another 20-point reaction paper, just like every other reaction paper that we do. This one has two activities, and one activity is to start collecting information about your technology use. There are three ways to collect information about your technologies. These are all outlined in detail in the document posted here that says Reaction Paper 2 Instructions, read first. That means read it first. You'll notice underneath there that there are six other documents. There are three in, they're duplicates. There's three in Microsoft Word format and the same three in PDF format. Doesn't really matter whichever one you want to read, whichever's easier for you. I don't really care. I just try to give you the options. But read the Reaction Paper 2 instructions, read first, because that tells you how you're going to collect information about your technology use, your daily technology use, and what you're going to eventually do with it, excuse me, and how to also turn in the reaction paper. The reaction paper is not due until March 7th, but you're going to be needing to collect data for at least 7 full days. And so that means you need to start 9 days in advance, basically, because the day you start won't be a full day, and the day you finish and submit your data won't be a full day. If you have questions about any of this, you know how to get in touch with us. People have already started asking questions. Feel free to ask questions at your leisure. So, there are no questions yet. So I want to go back and remind you that we saw some pictures last time. We saw the trailer from Avatar and an MRI showing the brain activity for this 20 to 25-year-old male watching the trailer for Avatar. By the way, this process where they take a trailer or a product or anything and watch somebody's brain activity is called neuromarketing. It's really an up-and-coming field, and what it basically is it's assuming that the more brain activity you have, the more interested you are in general. But also, if you look on the screen and you look at personal meaning and executive attention, they look very carefully at the activation of those areas. So if they're showing you a commercial for a new toothpaste, for example, and they want you to look at the toothpaste and listen to the description about it, they're real interested to see if your brain lights up. That's what they call it, lighting up. Lighting up just means that there's blood flow there, carrying oxygen and glucose molecules, which is what your brain needs in order to be activated. And so it looks at these areas, the attention executive, which we'll talk about in the personal meaning area. So we looked at the Avatar trailer. We did not look at the Obama speech, but I recommend that you look at it. It's online under PowerPoints. We did look at the Harry Potter movie and saw the same thing. And there's another trailer for Up, the movie Up, which was out in 2009, and this is their Super Bowl spot. And if you're really interested in this, you can go to MindSign online, and they have lots more videos there. So let's talk a little bit about the brain. The brain weighs about 2 pounds. It's a very small proportion of your body, but it uses 20 to 25% of the energy. And by energy, I mean the blood flow, the glucose, the oxygen molecules, everything that produces activity in your brain and your body. As we mentioned, and as you saw in the videos, your brain does not use 10%. It's a fallacy, it's a myth. Your brain is functioning, basically your whole brain is functioning all the time. If you want to see something interesting about this, go online and look up glass brain. Some people at University of California, San Francisco have produced a video where they show you, literally show you what brain function looks like as though you're looking into someone's brain, except they replace the skull with glass. And so you can actually see the brain functioning, how it works, and you'll notice that it's way more than 10% of the brain that's going on all the time. So I want to show you, first of all, to start, we can go back to the screen, I want to show you some ways of looking at brain activity. One way is to look at problematic brains, brains that are carried by people who have psychiatric disorders, physical disorders. So the top strip you can see here is the brain of somebody who's hypomanic. That means, you know what manic means, mania, that means activity. Your brain is flowing all the time. You have lots of thoughts, lots of ideas. And you can see that hypomanic brain, they show all these areas that are lit up. That means where all the oxygen and blood flow and glucose is. And you can see that hypomanic brains are very highly active. If you compare that to depressed brains, you can see they're much less active. Only activity, they're showing it mostly in green here. Much less activity, much less activity. There is some relatively new research showing that brain connectivity is linked to depression, but they call it hyperconnectivity, meaning it's overly connected. Meaning there's too much activity, which suggests that people who are depressed because they actually have too much hitting their brain all at the same time. That's a testable hypothesis, and it's being tested as we speak. Here's another sample of brains doing a task, and they usually, the way this works is they have people do a task, and they would have somebody normal with a normal brain do a task, and then somebody who's autistic do a task. And so this is the brain activity for exactly the same task. And you see for the normal person, and I forget what the task is here, but you see for a normal person, they have activity here in the prefrontal cortex a lot, and they have activity back here, which is probably close to the hippocampus, which is the seat of memory. It's where your memories start, where they reside, and then they get shuttled out to the rest of your brain. You notice in the same task, the autistic brain has less in this area. And then you see from the top view of the brain, this is probably the amygdala, which is the seat of emotions and reward and risk-taking and a few other things. And you can see that the normal brain shows more activity up here and activity in three other different areas, whereas the autistic brain shows just simply less activity. Here's another study where they're looking at a task between a control subject and doing a task in an ADHD subject. And it's interesting, most people think that ADHD means you're hyperactive and your brain must be just flowing all over the place. But that's in general not true. For the same task, the control brain showed a lot of activity across the brain, prefrontal cortex area, in a variety of the cortical areas, whereas the ADHD brain was very focused. One of the symptoms of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is a brain that's highly focused. This is a very interesting study done at UCLA by Dr. Gary Small, who actually based an entire book on this called iBrain. And what he did is he took some older people who had never used Google before. And what he first did is had them read a book and in an MRI machine. And this is the brain activity when they're reading the book. There's a lot of activity going on, as you can see. And a lot of this is in the memory areas and the processing areas for new ideas. And then he taught them how to use Google and then set them loose using Google in an MRI scanner. By the way, that's a big challenge because you can't have metal in an MRI scanner. So they have to create a completely plastic computer, basically, with very little metal so it doesn't affect the MRI scanner. But you can see that searching Google required a lot more of the brain for these older people. Certainly the same areas here, and this area matches this area, but this is more activity in the prefrontal cortex, meaning that reading a book has less prefrontal cortex activity, and you'll see in a few minutes what that means, than actually searching for information, at least at the beginning. They did not follow these people, so we don't know if they continued to need more activity, but my suspicion is that they probably did. This is an example of some distracted brains, and you can see the areas of the brain that light up when you're distracted. And particularly, there's a bunch of research, and I'm going to talk a little bit about this later, that these three areas plus another area up here, when they are activated together, those four areas, it's called the default mode network. And the default mode network is when you are doing non-focused thinking, meaning you're letting your mind wander, you're being creative, you're dreaming or daydreaming. Those four areas light up. So being distracted is somewhat like flipping into that default mode network, almost. It's not a complete default mode network. But what it is it's an activation of areas that allow your mind to wander from what you're supposed to be doing to what you aren't supposed to be doing. So part of the problem comes from the area we talked about behind your forehead called the prefrontal cortex. And you can measure prefrontal cortex activity by putting a little band across someone's forehead. This is obviously me. Well, you don't know this is me, but this is me with a band on my forehead. It's hard to see me there. And it's measuring my prefrontal cortex, and you can see 16 little boxes here. It measures it in 16 different locations on my forehead because there are different functions in different parts of the prefrontal cortex. Some areas are the executive controller, controlling what's going on. Some are your working memory, which would be if you're working on a math problem, say, or thinking something through. You bring information in from other parts of your brain into the prefrontal cortex, and it kicks it around and works on it. Your areas of attention and focus, the areas of the prefrontal cortex that help you focus on information that you need to or be distracted. Your decision-making areas, there's areas controlling multitasking, and then really importantly for young people, there's areas of impulse control. By the way, the multitasking and the impulse control is right down the middle of your forehead, and that's the part where your brain creases in, and it's hard to get at those areas, which is why they're so tough to counteract. They're kind of buried inside your brain. So let's talk about young people and how they develop. Can we come back to me? Thanks. What you see on the screen, and you don't need to see it full screen, what you see on the screen is a neuron. The neuron's composed of dendrites and axons, little things that stick out. And the ends of those little things that stick out communicate with the ends of other little neurons and axons and dendrites that stick out by sending chemicals or electrical signals. They're both sent along these little tracks. And if we come back to the screen, I'll show you on the screen. So imagine can we come back to the PowerPoint screen, please? We're coming, slowly. Everybody in the control room just fell asleep. There we go. So here's our neuron. Sorry, here's our neuron right here, and here's some dendrites sticking out of the neuron, and then here's axons going out. And at the end, you see these endpoints. The neuron itself sends signals out here, but in particular, it sends them out here on the axons. And when they reach this little point, those signals, whether they're electrical or biochemical, are shot out, and then another neuron that's sitting right here will have axons or dendrites that will either accept those signals or reject those signals. The problem is that when babies are born, essentially all of their neurons are uncovered neurons. And what I mean by uncovered is if you imagine a wire going from the wall to a lamp, that wire is not just bare electrical wire. If it was just bare electrical wire, you'd see sparks all over the place and probably set your house on fire. It's covered with a nice rubbery plastic coating that allows the signal to go from the wall socket to the lamp to the light bulb to light the light bulb up. Well, you can consider a neuron like this like an electrical circuit. And in order for the signal to come from here all the way out to here or to here, it has to travel along this axon. And if that signal travels along this axon when the baby is born, it's bare. There's no coating. Eventually, what happens are these little fatty cells called myelin start migrating, and they start coating the axons. See that? They start coating the axons. So signals still get away, they still escape, but eventually, it's called a myelin sheath. Eventually, everything's coated, and so signals can go straight from the neuron all the way out to the axon, and then you can even see, they show a side view here of where the signals go out. And again, those signals can be either biochemical, and we'll talk about some of the chemicals, it can either be biochemical or they can be electrical. Interestingly enough, the last area of your brain to be myelinated is your prefrontal cortex. And if you look at this picture, it shows the amount of myelin in your brain and shows that really not until you're in your 20s, your mid, even late 20s, maybe even into your 30s, is there enough myelin in there to cover the neurons in your prefrontal cortex. So you can imagine, if we come back to me for a second, I'll show this visually. You can imagine that your prefrontal cortex up here is your executive controller, and yet it's not myelinated when you're young, say when you're 5 or 10 or 15 or 17 or 20 or 22, meaning that the signals from the neurons in here, and it's a very rich area, the signals from the neurons may not get directly from one neuron to another because they may go off with because the myelin sheath is not completed. And so the signals may never get from point A to point B. They might start going there and then they flare off. And if it's electrical, they go off like an electrical signal. If it's biochemical, which most of it is, they go off by the chemicals being leaked into the wrong place. Interestingly enough, if we come back to the picture here, you can see that the amount of myelin increases until you're about 45, at which point then you start to become demyelinated and the myelin drops dramatically so that by the time you're 75, you really have about the same thinking patterns as a 15-year-old. So I'm right about here, 68, so my thinking pattern is like about a 20-year-old, which makes sense. Demyelination also occurs in a lot of diseases. Multiple sclerosis, multiple dystrophy. There's a whole bunch of diseases that are myelination diseases where the myelin is disintegrating prematurely. It's also why, by the way, when you're 75, I don't think I have any 75-year-olds in the class, but if you're 75, this is why you might walk to the refrigerator, open the refrigerator door, and not remember what the heck you're doing there and what you wanted in the first place. Or you might keep looking for your keys in exactly the same place over and over again. It's because the signal is not getting through because it's demyelinated. So brain development shows two basic surges of brain matter. One is right prior to puberty, and that's the gray matter that covers much of your brain. And then after that, what happens is a process called synaptic rejuvenation, which means that brain cells that are not needed or brain connections that are not needed are pruned away. And you can think of that as pruning a tree. You cut off parts of it. They're just thrown away. Or important brain cells are consolidated. Important connections are consolidated. You can see here that in terms of this is the prefrontal cortex up here, the thinking part of your brain. But you can see that in terms of the total volume of your brain, the volume of your brain peaks somewhere in your 40s and then starts deteriorating after that. So imagine somebody who's 15, 17, 22 studying, and imagine that model I brought, the network association model, imagine that these are all networks. And you can see that the prefrontal cortex is having trouble juggling all of these things all at the same time because it's not completely myelinated. Your brain's magical. And what's interesting, and this is one of my favorite slides, is this is the brain learning a new task. And it can be any task. I forget what this study was. I have to go back and reconstruct it in my head. But when you learn a new task, you use lots of your brain. You can see this is probably using, I'd say 20%, 25% of your brain easily, as the MRI shows. Once you've learned the task and you have mastered it, look how little of your brain power you need in order to perform that task. This is what I was describing the other day when I was talking about the sort of automatic learning, the automaticity model of learning, and how your brain, on well-learned tasks, your brain seems to go on automatic, and it seems to work rather than working from outside, you're working from inside. And I think I use the driving to school example, that when you first time you drive to school, your brain would look like this. You're checking out all the directions, you need to know where to get off the freeway, you need to know which street to go on, you need to know how to get to the parking lot, you need to know how to get a parking pass, do all those things. Once you've done it, it's like, doesn't take much brain power. You leave home, you'll all of a sudden find yourself in your parking space. So what do we know about how technology impacts the brain? There's a tremendous amount of research going on this topic. I will now and later on in the semester be bringing in research from something called the ABCD Project, which is a project that started with thousands of 10 and 11-year-olds, and they're tracking them over a 20-year period, and particularly paying attention to what is the impact of technology use. They tried to get the kids before they started using technology at 10 or 11 and watching their brains changing as they grow older. They've already started to publish some work. They've been going for about 5 years, so they're now looking at 15, 16-year-olds. And they already published something that suggested that those who use technology more in general tend to have more what they call thinning of the cortex, meaning the top part of your brain, the outer edge of your brain, is thinning. Now, interesting enough, it's not clear whether that's good or bad, because brains, the outside of your cortex tends to thin anyway as you age, but this is just premature thinning. So it thins earlier than it should naturally. So we don't know what it means yet, but the ABCD project is tracking all these people, thousands of them. What we do know from some other research is if you have more social network friends, you show an increased size of your hippocampus and amygdala. I mentioned the hippocampus. It's a funny word, but it's probably Latin. The hippocampus is the seat of memory. It doesn't mean that all your memories are stored there. It simply means that it's the seat of memory. It's where memories are consolidated. Oftentimes, what happens is information that's learned goes first to the hippocampus. It's worked on in the hippocampus, and then it's apportioned out to other parts of the brain where memories are stored. The amygdala is the source of emotions, and positive or negative emotions. And so if you have more social network friends, you have larger memory and larger amygdala. Video gamers, just generic video gamers, show increased activity in what's called the striatum, which is an area of the brain that deals with risks and reward. So that makes sense. If you're playing video games, it's kind of a risk-reward kind of process. That's what a game is, really. You take a risk, you get a reward. And they show an increased size of the striatum. Violent video game players, and you've been reading about that in the book, since I know you're all judiciously reading the book well ahead of the exam, violent video game players show increase in the aggression areas but decrease in the amygdala, the center of emotions. That's interesting. So there's more aggression but with less emotion to it. And then web addicts, there was one study on web addicts that showed that the brain showed overall more activity when in the web addicts, but less efficiency of neural conduction. What that means is that the neurons were not very efficient at sending either electrical or biochemical signals from one neuron to the other. So let's talk a little bit about brain chemistry. If we can come back to me for a second. The brain is full, the brain and your body are full of chemicals. We already talked about, the other day we talked about the limbic system. What I'm gonna do is talk about a bunch of other systems today, but there are primarily some interesting sets of chemicals in your brain that need to be attended to. One set is what's called the dopaminergic center or the dopaminergic system. What that is it's composed of a variety of chemicals, and I'm just going to give you the names of the major ones because there are lots of little ones that you don't really need to know. But the two major chemicals in the dopaminergic system are dopamine, which maybe you've heard of, and serotonin, which maybe you've heard of. Serotonin, you might have heard of because psychotropic medications for depression, things like Prozac, are called SSRIs, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. What that means is the drugs stop serotonin from being sucked back from the centers of your brain, from in between the neurons, being sucked back into the neurons of your brain. So what does serotonin do? The theory is that the more serotonin molecules you have floating around freely in the brain, the happier you are. Serotonin are called the happy molecules. Dopamine is an interesting one. When you look at people who are addicted to anything, doesn't matter what it is, if it's addiction to pornography, addiction to gambling, addiction to sex, it doesn't really matter what you're addicted to, even addiction to video games, you find that that playing the game, doing the activity, sparks the release of dopamine, and dopamine gives you a feeling of pleasure. We're not born knowing that dopamine gives you a feeling of pleasure. We're known knowing that dopamine gives us a feeling, And we learn over time that that feeling is a good feeling and it's a pleasurable feeling. And a little bit of dopamine is great. A little bit of dopamine makes us happy, just like serotonin makes us feel good. The problem is that dopamine is a habituating chemical. And what that means is that if you need 5 milligrams, I'm just going to use these random numbers here, but if you need 5 milligrams to feel this happy today, then you might need 10 milligrams to feel the same happy in a week. And then you might need 20 milligrams to feel the same happy in 5 weeks. So you continue to need more and more dopamine to feel just as happy. It's called habituation. You habituate to it. And we see this a lot in gamers that they will need to play. They can play an hour at the beginning when they're playing a game and feel really happy about the game. But then the next time they play the game, they need to play 90 minutes to feel just as happy. What's going on in the background is they're needing more dopamine. Their brain needs more dopamine to feel that same level of happiness. So that's one of the systems. Another system is sort of, you can see sort of partially in here on the slide on the left side, but that's the anxiety system. I think maybe I have it on, yeah, I have it on here. Let's talk about the anxiety system. 2/3 of teens and young adults check their phones every 15 minutes or less. That's one of the questions that you on the survey that you did. Half get anxious if they can't check, and 3/4 of teens and young adults sleep with their phone ringer on or set to vibrate, and half of all adults use their smartphone as their alarm clock. So before I talk about a study of anxiety, let me talk about the chemicals that go into dealing with this. So imagine that you are an anxious person. And let's take it to the extreme, and I'll show you a video in a few minutes of taking it to the extreme. But let's suppose that you're anxious about germs, okay? So you're anxious about germs, and so what you do is you keep those wipes with you, those Lysol wipes, and and you wipe every surface that you go by. You walk by a surface and you wipe that surface. What is controlling that wiping of that surface? Well, what's controlling that is the leaking of chemicals in your brain that are part of the anxiety circuit. It's like the dopaminergic circuit, but it's part of the anxiety circuit. The 2 or 3 most common chemicals in there are cortisol, adrenaline, alpha amylase, norepinephrine. Those are the common chemicals that are part of the anxiety system. Most people refer to it as the cortisol system because cortisol is the primary chemical that makes you feel anxious. How did cortisol make us feel anxious? How did we learn this? If you're a young person, and imagine all of a sudden you're a young person and you start to feel heart palpitations and your palms start to get a little sweaty, your armpits start to get a little sweaty, your brain gets a little fuzzy. How do you identify that? Well, most people, if their hands get sweaty, will identify it as anxiety. Physiologically, what's happening is the amount of chemicals in the anxiety system, and I'm just going to call it cortisol for now to simplify it, the cortisol starts increasing, meaning that the adrenal gland starts releasing cortisol, and that's giving you these outward symptoms. We link these symptoms with anxiety. So we say, oh, my palms are sweaty, I must be anxious. I've got a test today and my palms are sweating, I must be anxious. I'm going to ask a girl out, my heart's pounding, I must be anxious. We've assigned those labels of anxiety. The chemicals don't make you anxious, they give you the outward symptoms that we label as anxiety. That's really important when we're talking about technology, because as you're going to see from some of our research, anxiety is a driving force in why people use technology. So let me run through an interesting study that we did. I'm going to come back to the screen, thank you. It's a study done by my colleague, Dr. Nancy Cheever, and my other colleagues, Dr. Mark Carrier, and our student, one of our graduate students before. What Dr. Cheever did is she had 163 college students come into one large lecture hall, and half of them were randomly told to go in one door, and the instructions were when they went in that door, they were to go in, sit down, put their stuff underneath their chair, turn their phone off, and put it with their stuff. They were not to sit next to someone. They were to sit at least one seat apart, and they were not to say a word. they were just supposed to sit there and do nothing. She was trying to induce boredom and anxiety at the same time. The other half of the students came in the other door, and they were told exactly the same instructions, except they were given a claim check for their smartphone to pick up later. So half of them had their smartphone turned off underneath their seat. Half of them had their smartphone removed. Interestingly enough, the title of the article is "Out of Sight is Not Out of Mind." So just because the phone was out of sight, removed, was not out of mind. So then what she did is, with a paper and pencil measure, she measured anxiety three different times, 10 minutes into doing nothing, 30 minutes into doing nothing, and 50 minutes into doing nothing. So here are the results. Here's 10 minutes in on the bottom, 30 minutes in, 50 minutes in, and higher numbers mean more anxiety. So what she did is she divided people into three groups based on their typical smartphone usage, meaning how many hours a day they use their smartphone. Light daily phone users, moderate daily phone users, heavy daily phone users. Nothing magical about it. She just took their use of phone statistics, how much they used it each day. She split them into a third for light, a third you'll see for moderate, and a third you'll see for heavy users. So what about the light phone users? Over the 50 minutes, their anxiety stayed exactly constant. Low, constant anxiety. What about the moderate users? Well, first of all, at the 10 minutes in, they were just as non-anxious as the light users, but all of a sudden, at 30 minutes in, they start to get anxious, and then that anxiety levels off. So moderate users show a moderate level of anxiety, basically, but it takes a while for it to kick in. It didn't kick in 10 minutes. It had to kick in all the way at 30 minutes. What about the heavy users? What's your guess out there? Well, first of all, at 10 minutes, they're already more anxious. At 30 minutes, they're more anxious. And at 50 minutes, they're really more anxious. And in fact, this is pretty much the top of the scale. So with heavy users, when you take away their phone, and by the way, it didn't matter whether we took away their phone and gave a claim check, or whether she took away their phone and had them put it under her desk, showed exactly the same results. So here's a video of what can happen from too much anxiety. While they're setting it up, I'll give you a little preamble. This is from a movie called As Good As It Gets. It stars Jack Nicholson, and he has obsessive compulsive disorder, which is a disorder that you have when you have too much anxiety about things. It's sort of the end result of too much anxiety. And it will be running shortly. So you'll notice I don't know if you saw that movie, it's a great movie, co-stars Helen Hunt, but Jack Nicholson has obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD, and you could see that he had to unlock and lock his door five times and count to five. He had to turn on and off his switch for his lights and count to five, and then he had to wash his hands under steaming hot water, so hot that he was saying hot, 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 with a fresh bar of soap. And if we kept going on the video, I think it stops there actually, but I think if you watch it in the real movie, he also washes his hands five times. He does everything five times. It's what he feels keeps him safe. And biophysically, biochemically, what's happening is he's getting flooded with molecules like cortisol. And the more cortisol he has in his system, the more anxious it makes him. And the only way he can rid himself of the anxiety is to turn on and off lights, to open and close doors, to wash his hands. As if you watch the movie, you'll see to line up his silverware in the diner that he goes to not step on any cracks when he walks down the sidewalk. There's all sorts of repetitive activities, but what those repetitive activities do is it momentarily reduces the amount of cortisol or alpha amylase or any of those chemicals in his brain. We're finding that that's about the same with technology. So let's go back and talk about models of how we think. Remember the model that I put on the board or put on the screen last time, the network association model. How does that explain dreaming? Well, when you dream, think about your brain, it's making free associations. It's making free links from node to node. And since there's nothing really controlling it, we'll talk about sleep and dreaming in a bit, but since there's nothing really controlling it, it just goes naturally. Same thing with video game playing. You're sort of creating those kind of situations where your brain is just going and it's bringing in associations. Sleep is probably the most dramatic case. Your brain absolutely needs sleep in order to process things. Doctors recommend 9 hours per night for preteens and teenagers. I don't know any teenager that gets 9 hours. The average teen sleeps about 6 hours per school night, 10.3 hours on the weekend. It's called a sleep debt. If you add it up, they're still 12 hours per week shy, which is why teenagers will all of a sudden fall asleep in class, take a long nap, whatever they need to do in order to pay off that sleep debt, because the sleep debt is required. You can't forgive a sleep debt. Your brain needs it to be paid off. So if you go a day or so or 2 days studying really hard for exams and you don't sleep very much, you have to pay that back, and usually it gets paid back by sleeping really long one or two nights or taking long naps. 80% of teenagers say they rarely or never get a good night's sleep. And so what are we looking at here? Well, adults and teenagers, about two-thirds, reach for their phone immediately upon awakening, and that actually is a little bit of an old statistic. I saw one the other day that puts the number closer to 70%. 74% of millennials, of young millennials, reach for that phone, and I think those numbers are, again, a little low. It's up in probably in the high 70s, low 80s now, and 79% of adults in general reach for their phone within 15 minutes of awakening, but 89% of 18 to 24-year-olds do. So let me tell you why sleep is so critical. First of all, your brain is 95% as active during sleep as it is during awakening time. Most people think of their brain as being very quiet and inactive, but that's not true. And the only part that's less active is the prefrontal cortex, which, if you remember, the prefrontal cortex is what's guiding your brain to do what it does, to make it help it think what it thinks, to focus its attention, to focus on decision-making. So that explains a little bit about why we dream the way we do. I mentioned synaptic rejuvenation already. Consolidation and pruning are two things that happen. Your brain at night prunes away stuff it thinks it doesn't need and consolidates or practices information that you learn during the day that it thinks it needs. Your brain also does this process that's very interesting. Excuse me. During the day, as I mentioned, your brain swaps chemicals from neuron to neuron. It doesn't use the full chemicals. It uses most of the molecules in the chemicals, but some molecules get thrown away. And when they get thrown away, they just drift endlessly through your brain. A lot of those molecules, not a lot, but some of those molecules are called beta amyloids. And interestingly enough, beta amyloids, when you get enough of them in your brain, pull together to form something called plaques, which is like kind of like the plaque on your teeth, really. It's a hard substance and it inhibits learning. And in fact, when they dissect the brains of deceased Alzheimer's patients, they find that they have a lot of beta amyloid plaques in their brain. So what does a good brain do at night? your spinal column opens up a little bit extra and sends spinal fluid into your brain, sort of like the concept of a bidet, where it sends it up into your brain and flushes out those toxins. The problem with this is all of this synaptic rejuvenation only happens if you get a good night's sleep. If you don't, your brain skips all these things and causes problems. We already talked about the default mode network, creative thinking, daydreaming. And then one of the most important processes that goes on with your brain is called neuroplasticity. What it means is your brain is not set. People used to believe that by the time you were about 2, sometimes 3 to 4, your brain was set and would have as many neurons as it was ever going to have. That is not true. Neuroplasticity means that as you grow, your brain changes. It's plastic, it changes. It gets, some cells go away, some connections go away, new cells are there, new connections are made. Your brain is plastic. It is continually expanding, although not in size, but is continually expanding in its functions. When you look at research on teenagers, and young adults, you call them millennials, I guess, you see what they, the activities they do in the hour before they go to sleep, almost all of them are on their smartphone or on the internet. They are doing some schoolwork. Of course, they're multitasking all of this at the same time. We'll talk about that after the exam. They're texting, Facebooking or social media, listening to music, playing videos, email, watching a little TV. Young adults and teenagers, 75% of them sleep with their phone either on vibrate or leave the ringer on. And this is, of course, a visual depiction of what happens to them. So what does the research show when teens have disrupted sleep? And this goes for adults too, by the way, which is much of the research comes out on teens. Some people think it's the light. What does that mean? Well, when you are... Actually, let me come back and talk about this to the screen. When you wake up in the morning and you look at the sky, you see the sky is blue. Blue light releases cortisol. Cortisol is a stimulating chemical. In small amounts, it starts waking up. I think I've said this before, but I'll say it again since I don't know if people are actually watching these or not. So maybe you'll get it twice. What the cortisol does is it wakes you up slowly. Later on in the day, say around 4 o'clock, 4:15, 4:30, the light outside starts changing from blue to slightly pinkish as you go towards dusk, and that color light stimulates the pineal gland to put out melatonin. Melatonin, as you well know, is a chemical that puts you to sleep. Everybody knows what melatonin is. Melatonin is the chemical that slowly over time puts you to sleep. The interesting thing about the interaction between cortisol and melatonin is that cortisol, when it's released, it shuts down the melatonin. It inhibits melatonin release. So how does this all fit with technology? Well, it turns out that if you're sitting there with your phone looks like the color of the screen is sort of bluish white, right? It's kind of a bright blue-white color. It's actually a heavy dose of light in the blue part of the spectrum. Guess what blue light does? Blue light stimulates the adrenal gland to secrete cortisol. So imagine a teenager or a young adult or yourself at night. You have, your bedtime is 11:30. At 11 o'clock, you're still happily on your smartphone, holding it very close to your face, getting a lot of dose of blue light in there. The blue light is increasing the cortisol is shutting off the melatonin, and so you may fall asleep at 11:30, but you will have sleep problems. Sleep problems mean waking up at night a lot, not being able to get back to sleep for long periods of time after you wake up, having disordered sleep, meaning you're not going through the sleep phases, and I'll talk about those in a second. So it is the light. Is it what we call couch potato activities? Say you watch TV. Many people have a television in their room. Say you watch TV at night. Is that a problem? Well, it turns out if your TV is more than a few feet away from your face, the blue light comes off of the device. Blue light comes off of any LED-based device, and your TVs are all LED-based devices now, as are your smartphones and your tablets. So you imagine your TV, which is pretty far away, the blue light comes off. It doesn't come like this and come straight into your face. It goes like this and spreads out. And after about 12 to 14 inches away, so about that far away, the blue light, most of it goes out around your head. Very little of it gets into your retina. Very little of it then stimulates cortisol. So, for example, the Mayo Clinic recommends that if you want to watch or use a device, that you hold it about 14 inches away from your face and also turn the brightness down. Turning the brightness down reduces the amount of blue light, which reduces the amount of cortisol. So your television is fine. In fact, one of the recommendations is you can watch TV. Is it computer use? No, it turns out it isn't, because again, you're sitting on your computer, you're usually about at least 14 inches away from your screen, so the light is dissipating away from you. So what is it? Well, it turns out that what disrupts sleep most from the research is incessant nighttime multitasking, smartphone use close to your face, and cell phone interrupted sleep. So let me talk about what happens during sleep. Sleep happens in phases. And the way it works is your brain makes you fall asleep. The melatonin inhibits wakefulness, basically, and turns your brain into what's called light sleep. You go through four stages of sleep, stage one, stage two, stage three, stage four, sleep getting heavier and heavier and heavier. You might notice that as soon as you fall asleep, sometimes you startle and wake up. That's because you're in such a very light sleep that any noises are going to peak you and wake you up, or any internal noises from your brain are going to get you and pop you awake, and then you will go back into that sleep phase. So you go through, a good night's sleep goes through four phases: light, heavier, heavier, heavier. At the end, then it goes into what's called REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep. This is when, if you watch someone, their eyes are fluttering, and that means they're dreaming. Your first bout of REM sleep is very short. Your first dream of the night is very short. It's about 3 minutes. And again, this is only if you're a well-rested person. I'm talking about well-rested people here. Once your 3 to 5 minute dream is over, you go back down into second phase, light sleep, heavier, 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 dream, longer dream. You go through four of those phases in a typical night. Heavier, 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 dream. Light, heavier, 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 dream. Light, heavier, 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 dream. Light, heavier, heavier, heavier. The last dream is usually about an hour, which is why most people in the morning will wake up in the middle of their last dream, if you're a well-rested person. What happens if you're not a well-rested person? Well, first of all, you have less deep sleep, and deep sleep turns out to be when most of the consolidation and pruning and flushing out the toxins happen, although it happens also during all the other phases of sleep. But primarily, as it gets heavier sleep, that means your brain is working harder, and it's consolidating more, it's pruning more, it's flushing out toxins. It also disrupts the cycles. You might find that when you're exhausted and you go to sleep, you don't go light, heavier, 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 you go dream, straight into dream. You'll notice this, by the way, if you're a napper. Oftentimes nappers tell me that as soon as they lay down for a nap, they start dreaming. That's because they're exhausted and their brain is not going to go through the phases to get to dreaming. It's going straight to dreaming, which means it's not doing its handiwork in the background. It's not flushing out toxins. It's not consolidating. It's not pruning. It's not doing any of that. And leaving less time for that default mode network to click in, that clicks in during REM sleep, that helps you be more creative. So here's some sleep recommendations. The National Sleep Foundation, which funds much of this research, says get all your technology out of your bedroom an hour before sleep. Get it all out. No smartphone, limited technology, only stuff that's well-learned, which takes less use of your brain. So what can you do? There's really three options. You can read a paper book. If you read a paper book, the light coming off a paper book reflected is not in the blue spectrum. It's actually in the pink spectrum. So it actually will inhibit the cortisol and increase the melatonin. You can also watch TV because the television set is far enough away that it's not giving off a lot of blue light, although I recommend that in order to keep your brain as inactive as possible, that you watch a TV show that you're really familiar with, so that you know all the characters, so your brain doesn't have to build up the structures, those nodes and connections about the characters, and maybe even a repeat of a show that you've seen before. I really like going back and watching repeats of Big Bang Theory just before I go to sleep, because it helps my brain. I mean, I know the characters. I know everything about the characters. It lets my brain just kind of go into default mode and just think. And then the other one is listen to music. Surprisingly, even though you have to do it on your phone, you can shut your phone down except for the music function. And I recommend that people only listen to a playlist that they know really well. So all your favorite songs. Make a playlist of all the songs that you could sing in your sleep. And that will help you fall off to sleep much easier. Want to talk to you about a study that shows the impact of tech on sleep. We used 734 college students. Actually, they were students from this class, not this semester, but from another semester. And we measured executive functioning, things that go on in the prefrontal cortex. We measured anxiety by self-report anxiety. We measured smartphone use by self-report, how much you use it, and then where you put your phone at night and how much you use it at night. So this is, again, just some data, and it doesn't really matter if you understand this, but just understand that stars mean that these things go together. We're measuring sleep performance, good night's sleep. So good executive functioning means you have a good night's sleep. That's why there's no sign here. Think that there's a positive sign. Being anxiety or dependent on your smartphone leads you to a bad night's sleep. It's a negative. Preferring to multitask rather than do a task to completion leads you to a bad night's sleep. More smartphone usage during the day, interestingly enough, positive, leads you to a good night's sleep, but I'll show you how that's not really true. Awakening to check your phone actually leads you to a bad night's sleep. Having your phone next to your bed leads you to a bad night's sleep. Particularly nighttime awakenings, this was interesting. What we measured was sleep problems as a measure, natural measure of sleep problems. And most people, 372 of our subjects, said they never check their phone in the middle of the night for anything other than the time. They had the lowest sleep problems. Those who checked it once a night had a higher sleep problem, and those who checked it two or more times a night had the highest sleep problem score. So checking your phone in the middle of the night for something other than the time is going to stimulate your brain and make it difficult for you to sleep. Where you put your phone is interesting. Those who put their phone away, actually this is backwards. Those who kept their phone close at hand had more sleep problems than those who put their phone away. These numbers are reversed. And here's a model, and I'm going to show you other models like this, so I want to explain how this works. This is called a mediated model, meaning you have on the far left, you have what are called control variables. These are information about, usually about the person that's in the study, that you really don't care about. You don't really care about their SES, but SES, socioeconomic status, might affect sleep problems, so you're going to control it statistically. You're going to control it out. The fact that women sleep better than men, you're going to control out. Younger people and older people sleep differently. People of different cultural backgrounds sleep differently. So you're going to factor all those out. You really don't care. They're not part of your model. Then on the left-hand side are what are called independent variables. These are variables that either directly you think might predict sleep problems or indirectly might predict sleep problems by predicting some other mediator, something in the middle, that's what mediator means, which might predict sleep problems. So let me walk you through what we found. Executive functioning problems lead directly to sleep problems. That means if you don't make good decisions, if you're not a good decision maker, if you're a heavy multitasker, if you're impulsive, you're going to get a bad night's sleep. That's executive function problems also leads to stupidly checking your phone at night, which then leads to sleep problems. Makes sense, right? Having your phone next to the bed leads directly to sleep problems. That should tell you why the National Sleep Foundation says, get that phone out of the bedroom. And then anxiety dependence is interesting. It predicts more smartphone use, which predicts more sleep problems. It predicts more waking up in the middle of the night, which predicts more sleep problems. It also predicted multitasking preference, but that alone didn't predict sleep problems. So you see that this model explains a lot about why we have problems and the role the technology plays as mediator in the middle. This is a quote that I thought you would find interesting because this is done by a woman who's a neuroscientist but also a member of the House of Lords. And I think bottom line is she doesn't know what she's talking about, but it's always very interesting to see what Dr. Susan Greenfield has to say. So she said, if we were to scan, this is all supposition, by the way, this is not reality. If we were to scan the brains of young people who spend a lot of time playing computer games and in chat rooms, we would find that the prefrontal cortex is damaged, underdeveloped, or underactive, just as it is in gamblers, schizophrenics, or the obese. She's not totally wrong, by the way. We do find that the prefrontal cortex is problematic, but it's not damaged. It's not necessarily underdeveloped any more than it would be just by age. But what it is often underactive. It's not making good choices. So we have a few minutes here. We're going to show a movie. It's very interesting, and I think you'll enjoy it. And do we have the ability to roll it now? Tuesday, I will see you for the study guide, to go over the study guide questions. And since I didn't get any questions today, maybe nobody's watching live. So enjoy the movie, and we will talk to you on the other side of the movie. I think I'll have if I have a few minutes, I'll say hi and add some more. If not, I'll talk to you on Tuesday.
Now, what happens to teenage brains in a multitasking digital age? NewsHour science correspondent Miles O'Brien has our look.
It's a school night, and the 16-year-old Jane twins, Rocky and Anika, have a heavy load of homework ahead of them. So where to begin? How 20th century of me to think that way? The correct answer is, do everything all at once.
Well, right now I'm working on my physics lab and my Hamlet essay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also on Gmail doing chat and on Facebook chat.
Actually, everything and then some.
I'm doing my math homework. I'm editing an article for the newspaper. And then I'll worry about the other stuff later.
So you've got the Facebook, you have some chats going?
Yeah.
And then you've got three kinds of homework that you're working on at the same time?
Yeah.
The Janes are like most kids these days. It is second nature for them to be online, on the air, typing, texting, posting, perusing, constantly connected. Well-informed? Yes. But perpetually tempted and, well, to my eyes, distracted.
It's kind of addictive.
It is, yeah. Like, I know it's bad. I know I shouldn't be chatting with people because it's there, you know, to utilize your resources.
And all of this is likely affecting the Janes' brains at a crucial phase in their development. But how? Neuroscientist Jay Geede hopes to have an answer before too long.
The internet and iPods and Facebook and all of these video games and these changes are so recent in terms of human history that it's going to be very interesting to see how the brain adapts to doing all these different things, and often many of them at the same time.
The Janes are part of a 20-year study Dr. Geede is conducting at the National Institute of Mental Health to better understand how the adolescent brain develops. All the participants come in every 2 years for a gauntlet of tests, including some time in a magnetic resonance imaging machine, which captures the development of their brains in vivid detail.
So we're quite surprised to find that by age 6, the brain is already over 90% of adult size. So the size of the brain gets set surprisingly young, but what happens after that is the brain becomes more specialized. And it does this through a process called pruning. It's kind of the gardening metaphor of eliminating extra connections.
The prime time for pruning is adolescence. Connections that are used are strengthened. Those that are not are disconnected. This is the time when human beings learn to live independently in their environment. 10,000 years ago, teens would have been learning how to stay warm, what berries to eat, or how to hunt. Today, they're learning how to drink from a technological fire hose.
And in fact, in their adult jobs, they may be doing a lot of multitasking. But the other side of that coin is, will they become less good at focusing on one task, of being able to do one thing really well?
This is something I think a lot about when I'm not distracted by my own multitasking. Why? Well, because of these tech-savvy characters with voracious appetites for the online smorgasbord. That's my 18-year-old son, Murrah.
Oh, suck it.
Yo, dude, I have 16 kills.
Answering the call of duty with his pal, Dylan.
Merle wins!
How you doing?
On the other side of the apartment is 16-year-old Connery, who presides over a nonstop virtual salon. She and her coterie connect via text, instant messages, Facebook, and video chats.
Are you doing homework, Connery?
No.
Not even close?
No.
What are you doing?
I'm looking at funny pictures on Facebook.
Watch what happens when I try to interview her.
Here's the big question, though. You think that, of course, you know, with our chat, it kind of helps, but, you know, like, for example, like, what are you just doing? What are you just doing?
I'm just checking my texts and the time.
you couldn't even do the interview without doing a quick check, right? You know?
Sorry, that's just a reflex.
That's an addiction.
What have we wrought? Well, try this term on for size. Digital natives.
Digital natives are essentially young people who grow up with the technology 24/7. Their brains are wired to use it well, use it effectively.
Gary Small is a psychiatry professor at UCLA and co-author of iBrain, Surviving the Technological Alteration of the Modern Mind. He says we're creating a generation of technology addicts, for real. You see, every time we do something new and fun, our brain rewards us with a jolt of a chemical called dopamine. It's the drug our body secretes when we do something pleasurable and or addictive.
What the technology really does, it accelerates anything that is human, anything that we like. We can get addicted to being connected with other people through texting, through social networking, all kinds of programs that are very seductive to our brains.
It is seductive no matter what the age, but is it efficient? Can we really multitask? Well, yes, with a caveat.
We can do it, but at tremendous cost. You can't do two tasks as well as you can do each one separately.
Neuroscientist Marcel Just is doing some groundbreaking research on the human brain at Carnegie Mellon University.
So we pay a big penalty for doing more two things at once.
That's right. There's only so much brain capability at any one time, throughput. And you can divide it down as much as you want to, but the price will be even higher then.
Like driving and talking on the phone. A few years ago, Just did a study on this. His conclusion, even an idle conversation takes a 40% bite out of your brain power. You might as well be drunk.
So multitasking is not a myth, but efficient multitasking might be.
Yes. Multitasking with no cost is a myth. I think there's no free lunch there.
Oh boy, a little nervous.
But some people are better multitaskers than others, and it is harder for us non-digital natives, which is what brought me to Carnegie Mellon for a multitasking challenge. With headphones on, I tried to correctly answer a series of simultaneous questions like these.
The song America the Beautiful was written by the famous popular musician Mariah Carey.
There was a lot on the line here. I consider myself a good multitasker. You really should be if you're going to fly airplanes, as I do. So if I flunked this test, I would never hear the end of it. But only 40% of the students in the initial study passed.
So 100% on left and right, and why? 93% on dual.
93 on dual!
So you got it. Ha-ho!
Phew! I'm ready. Enough to save multitasking face and get me into the functional MRI, which images blood flow in the brain to show which areas are in use. And here are the results. This is my brain listening to just one question, and here I am trying to answer two at once. It ties up a lot more gray matter, and that matters a lot.
Thinking is a network function. Now, if you ask your brain to do two thinking tasks simultaneously, the two networks have to work at the same time, they have to communicate over the same channels.
So can we train our brains to do better? Daphne Bavalier thinks so. She is a professor in the Brain and Cognitive Sciences Department at the University of Rochester. She's done a lot of research on video game players. And parents, the news is a little bit counterintuitive.
We can show that they have better vision
the kind of skills that are not typically corrected by training, but corrected by your glasses, which is not something that you would think playing video games actually changes. And it's not only the case for vision, but it's also the case for attention, for different aspects of cognition, like multitasking, visual short-term memory.
And Bavalier says the games that are most beneficial are not the ones you might suspect. No disagreement from the Halo legend known as Flamesword, a.k.a. Michael Chavez. He is a professional video gamer. Yes, kids, you can get paid to do this, even though I hesitate to mention it.
I think faster. I have more outcomes in my head. I'm always thinking because, I mean, in the game, you're trying to accomplish certain tasks, and there's many different ways to accomplish these tasks. And if I could do it in the game, I feel like I'd do it in person, too. And I'm just always thinking of different ideas.
So is it possible we are collectively building better brains? Probably. They almost certainly are different.
We are dependent on technology, let's be honest here.
Yeah.
And, so it's definitely going to wire my brain differently than how your brain was wired growing up.
What is your generation going to be like as adults? Should we be worried about you running the world? I mean...
Don't be worried. We got this.
I suppose. Come back. Hello, we're back again. Hope you enjoyed that clip. I thought it was very interesting. And I just want to remind you again, if you're watching, the study guide is out now. We'll have a study session on Tuesday. On the study session, I will go over the kind of rules and ideas about the test, instructions about the test, what it's going to be like. I've already shared with you 15 sample questions. They came from last year's midterm. They're exact the kind of questions I asked, so you can get an idea of what I mean by thinking questions, BARF questions, or sort of knowledge factual questions, and book questions. And although we used a different book last year, so the book questions may not make much sense. And if anybody's around and live or wants to email in at askdhtvlive@gmail.com and ask a question, I'll be glad to answer it. Reaction paper 2, which is really important that you get started on it ASAP, and either download the app or create a diary for yourself to mark how much time you spend on your computer, how many times you unlock your phone. Very important. Excuse me. I've been using the app for years. I use the Moment app, and I find it very instructive as the information it gives me every day. And of course, now we'll talk later in the semester about the more detailed information that you're getting from, if you have iOS 12 or more on an iPhone, or if you have a specific, I think the Pixel phone that runs on Android also has their version. Apple's version is called Screen Time, which gives you information every day on how much you use your phone, how many times you unlock it, how many notifications you get, how many minutes you spend on each app. It's very interesting information. Google has their digital well-being, which does exactly the same thing. They're fighting about who came up with the idea first. I don't think it really matters. It's information. It's part of that quantified self movement that we talked about last time. So we'll hopefully see you on Tuesday for the study guide, and the exam is on Thursday. Thanks very much, and have a great rest of your day, evening, or morning.